Now, the recently concluded Supreme Court session and its impact on the law, policy, and politics. Judy Woodruff has that.
It was a term marked by major decisions on health care, immigration, criminal sentencing, and other big decisions. We take a look at how it played out and some historical context. And for that, I'm joined by Marcia Coyle, the Washington bureau chief at the National Law Journal, and Michael Beschloss, a presidential historian. They both join us now. It's good to have you both with us.
Thanks, Judy.
So, Marcia, let me start with you. What is this court term mainly going to be remembered for? Clearly, health care. Everybody's talking about that. But what else?
Well, I think I would add to that, Judy, that it's also going to be remembered because of health care and largely through the efforts of Chief Justice John Roberts, a term in which the court really extricated itself from one of the most politically charged terms in decades. But aside from health care, we also had a major politically charged case in the Arizona immigration challenge. And there the court, in a divided decision, found the federal law preempted most of Arizona's anti-immigration statute. There also were major decisions in the criminal justice area. If you recall, we talked about the decision, again, it was a 5-4 decision, though, of invalidating mandatory life sentences without parole for juveniles convicted of murder. The court also ruled that a fairly recent federal statute, the Fair Sentencing Act, which reduced sentences for crack cocaine offenses, did apply to a band of offenders who committed their crimes before the act took effect but were sentenced afterwards. A couple of major First Amendment cases, the Stolen Valor Act, which makes it a crime to lie about getting a medal. The court continued a trend of not wanting to carve out of First Amendment protection speech that a lot of us find very distasteful. They struck down that act.
Michael, what about that first point that Marcia made? The court noted for wanting to or succeeding in extricating itself from this perception that it was politically divided.
Absolutely.
How common is that? How ordinary is that in the history of our Supreme Court?
Usually it doesn't extricate itself. It usually lends itself to charges like that at crucial moments because, Judy, you look at what happened last week. This had all the makings of being FDR in 1936 when big parts of the New Deal were overruled by the Supreme Court. And the American people who were voting that year for or against Roosevelt took that as meaning not that the justices had applied legal theory and said this is not within the Constitution, but they took it to mean the New Deal is illegitimate, Roosevelt is a bad man, he shouldn't do anything else that extends the reach of the federal government. It was something that was very damaging and could have been to President Obama, I think, had this happened.
And Marcia, just by saying extricating itself, I mean, you're really talking about a conscious decision on the part of one or more justices to do that.
Well, I think so, Judy, although I think I wouldn't say that the court, that the justices, for example, the Chief Justice who formed a majority to uphold the Health Care Act and also was part of the majority striking down much of the Arizona Act, made a political decision. I really believe that he found a way consistent with his own view of the law to uphold the Health Care Act, and that was through the taxing power of Congress. I don't think he would have signed an opinion otherwise. But I think what he did was he and the other justices, and it did take give on the part of the more liberal wing of the court as well, on the Medicaid part of the act,
right,
that they made, they were able to show that this was more of a bipartisan, non-political decision. And that's how they were able to remove the court from really what's going to be a political debate concerning the election.
And Michael, back, you know, on the historical perspective, looking at this, to what extent have courts in the past felt or believed, to the extent we can know this, that it was damaging to be perceived as having a political divide,
well,
a divide along ideological
lines?
Sure.
Maybe the best example I can think of is 1974, U.S. v. Nixon, when the court was ruling on whether Richard Nixon, should have to give up his tapes, which were subpoenaed. And it was an 8-0 vote, including people whom Nixon had appointed. And some thought perhaps we should recuse ourselves. And actually, there was some discussion on the court at the time. We now know from diaries and later records that, no, it's better for us to have this ruling, including Nixon appointees, to show that this is not something that was on political lines.
Marcia, you mentioned a couple of other decisions here. I think one question that's come out of the decisions of this term is, what have we learned about the relationship of this court to other branches of government? Clearly, that question arises from the health care decision, but it does about some of these other decisions as well.
Well, it does. Health care, in particular, the Arizona immigration case. I think, Judy, even though the court upheld the individual mandate in the health care law, you have to look at the rest of the decision. You had the court putting some limits on Congress's power under the Commerce Clause, as well as its powers under the Tax and Spending Clause. In Arizona, though, you see Justice Kennedy writing an opinion that is very strong on the role of the national government in enforcing immigration laws. So I think it's hard to say this is a states' rights court, or this is always a national government court. It really depends on the issue that comes up. This is a conservative court, though, Judy.
How easy has it been, Michael, to classify courts in the past on the basis of whether they are a states' rights court?
Usually, it's been easy because they've tended to be categorized on the basis of their major rulings. Earl Warren's court, the Warren Court, was thought to be this wildly liberal, hugely big government-oriented court that was doing everything it could to legislate from the bench and extend the realm of the federal government. But if you microanalyze a lot of the decisions that were issued during those years, they don't really meet that template.
And Marcia, in terms of what the court did this term and the last couple of terms, what do you look for the next term? I mean, are there clear markers, or can we really draw no conclusions about cases are coming down?
I wish we could. This term was unusual in a couple of respects. There were some non-traditional alignments among the justices. You saw several justices going over to the left or to the right, depending on the particular issue, more so than we saw last term. You saw Justice Kennedy, who is obviously the swing vote and always in a majority of the 5-4 decisions. In the past, he pretty much dominated the majorities on the right, but this term, he swung evenly to the left and the right. So what does this mean for going forward? I would hesitate to say, because next term, it's a whole different round of issues that the court may face. For example, affirmative action, voting rights, gay marriage. Those are issues that some of the justices, including the chief, have very strong feelings about.
Do we err, Michael, too often in trying to read these alliances?
We sure do.
On the part of the justices.
Absolutely. Sometimes it gets really cartoonish. And one reason is the political atmosphere, because I guarantee you, supporters of both Barack Obama and Mitt Romney this year, you'll hear them saying, most important election in probably not American history, but world history, and the fate of the court hangs in the balance. And the premise there is that Romney will, if he gets appointments to be made, you know, we'll appoint robots who will always do what was considered to be the conservative ruling, and the same thing on the Obama side. So as long as the court is discussed in such a sloppy way that really doesn't fit reality very well during a campaign, people expect, I think, this to happen on the court. And as Marcia said, when you analyze the history, oftentimes it doesn't.
I think, Judy, too, someone said that this term should show most people that you can't really cover or read the court like you do Congress. It's a very different branch of government. And one other point, this is a young court in the sense that the Chief Justice has only been chief for 7 terms. And when you talk about a legacy, he's got probably 20 more years to serve.
It's good to be reminded of all that.
We're
it's
trying.
Not like covering the Congress. Marcia Coyle, Michael Beschloss, thank you both.
Thank you, Judy.
On our website, you can find a slideshow that highlights other major cases decided by the Supreme Court over the years.